Good morning, Lamb Church. Hope you guys are doing well. Again, sorry I wasn't with you last week and I had to give you a sermon just from YouTube, but I hope you were blessed anyways. We're gonna go and continue in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verses 18 to 29, and we will continue from there. Before I read, I wanna give a little bit of an update. We just came back from one of our mission/retreats with our leadership. Supporting the school in El Porvenir. You'll probably see on my Instagram that we're actually pretty active and getting some sponsors for some of the students. And it's been actually really, really good. There are some about 20 plus, 30 plus students that have a hard time paying tuition. And I think most all of them have been fully funded now. And some other projects that we're doing over there is for the first time, we're actually making a field turf in San Telmo, Mexico, which is really cool because they're favorite sport is soccer, and they always play on either the dirt or the gravel, and they always get injured, and the balls always get destroyed. And so having a field turf in this school is really going to be really awesome. On top of that, there's a new basketball court that's being built, and so God's support and love has been coming into San Telmo pretty rapidly. Ever since we came down here, God's just been blessing us and our whole family. On top of that, we're really, really excited. God's been doing a lot of things with the schools and the family down there, but also he's been doing a lot to raise up a lot of leaders in this pandemic and this difficult time. A lot of people are just spiritually super hungry. And I just want to say, God has really been pouring out during this time. Of course, we're doing all the social distancing and things like that, but God really blessed the group that we brought down, and we're going to pray to continue to bring more groups as we come as well. I wanted to actually introduce you to a special guest just for my introduction. Her name is Faith. Faith, you want to come? Yeah. Come quickly. She's with me at the Mission Center, and we're recording right now, and she wanted to say something. You want to say something?
Yeah.
What do you want to say? Okay, this is, there's Calvin, Justine, there is Yuna, and there is Vincent, and there's Hoon, and Teacher John, and everyone's there. You want to say hi to some of them? Yeah? Say hi.
Hi.
You miss them?
Yeah.
I miss you very much?
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to see them soon?
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to say thank you for the videos?
Thank you for the videos.
I love you, Hedjo. I love you.
I love you.
Okay. Papa, sorry, okay?
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right, guys. So that's a little bit of an update. If you can keep us in prayer, we'd really, really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Let's get into the Word. I'm going to read from verse 18 today. Again, I'm reading out of the NASB. And it says this. And to the angel of the church in Thyatira write, the Son of God, who has his eyes like a flame of fire, and his feet are like a burnished bronze, says this, I know your deeds, and I know your love and faith and service and perseverance, and that your deeds of late are greater than at first. But I have this against you, that you tolerate the woman Jezebel, who calls herself prophetess, and she teaches and leads my bondservants astray, so that they commit acts of immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. I gave her time to repent, and she does not want to repent of her immorality. Behold, I will throw her on a bed of sickness, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, unless they repent of her deeds. I will kill her children with pestilence, and all the churches will know that I am he who searches the minds and hearts, and will give each one of you according to your deeds. But I say this to you, to the rest who are in Thyatira, who do not hold to this teaching, who have not known the deep things of Satan, as they call them, I place no burden on you. Nevertheless, what you have, hold fast until I come. He who overcomes and he who keeps my deeds until the end, to him I will give all authority over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and vessels of the potter are broken to pieces. As I also have received authority from my Father, I will give him the morning star. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Now, in the beginning of this church, we are on now our fourth church out of the seven churches. And this is the church where we're actually going to see the decline start to happen. Right from the beginning, you will see that the majority, this is like a longer passage, but the majority of this passage, it is not a commendation. It's not the positive good things that the church has done, but majority of this text is actually rebuke and warning and challenge. And so as we look at this, we're actually looking where God is kind of turning and he's showing to show more of his righteousness and his justice, and where he calls this church to repent. Again, this is a message not just to the church Thyatira, but also to the universal church that is dealing with these things. Right from the beginning, we go to Thyatira. Thyatira is actually, it's a city that actually they have a lot of bronze and iron creating. And so that's why in Thyatira, Christ introduces himself as the Son of God, who has his eyes like a flame of fire and his feet like burnished bronze. Intentionally, Jesus Christ, to relate with what's going on with the church, he introduces himself with feet with burnished bronze. And the reason why he's introducing himself like this is because there is a God, there is a local God out there, and his name is Tyrannimus. And he identifies with like the sun god, Apollos. And so there is some worship going on, some false worship. There's the prophetess that is going in there that is giving false teaching. And this church is tolerating that. And so Christ introducing himself, first and foremost, he says, boom, I am the Son of God. I am God. I am the one, the Messiah that has sent. This is me. I am above every God. I'm above every local God. I'm above every local, regional, national God. I am God. And he specifies and speaks about fire and burnished bronze because he's saying, I'm not a God above the general gods, but I'm above all those that worship and give their alms and praise the God in your local place. I'm above that God. And so he gets very direct and very personal with this church. This comes and reminds us that Christ is a personal God. He's not a God that is distant and far away, but he's a God that is close and he is near and he is personal. And so he deals with our sins and our issues in a personal way, but he also loves and blesses us in a very personal way as well. This is the kind of God that we want to be overseeing and leading our church. Not a God who is distant, not a God that is far away and not close, but a God that is very near and dear to us. As he introduces himself to this church as a higher church, he also shows right there where it says, who has the eyes like flames of fire. This is speaking a little bit more of the justice and the righteousness of God. Not necessarily God's shepherd attributes, but his judgment and justice. His eyes are on flames. Those flames are to burn up all the impurities in people's lives. And as we look at Christ, he's speaking the same way. His eyes are on fire and he is not happy with this church. A lot of times people will think that Christ is just happy with church and the gathering and singing kumbaya. But no, there are certain things that Christ demands and requires of us. Why? Because if we are not walking in obedience with his word and in line with his character, then we go into this downward spiral where not only is God not glorified, it is now separated from what God desires, but also our life, the benefits that we have in Christ and the blessings, they slowly and surely get taken away from us because of our disobedience. Not because Christ lacks love or he loves us any less, but because we are choosing to go the route that brings us less blessing and condemnation. And so that's his introduction. He has this very small commendation, his encouragement to this church. He says, I know your deeds, your love and your faith and service and perseverance, and that your deeds of late are greater than the first. This is one really important encouragement and something that all churches should strive to be like. When we look at this church, it's in the beginning the church was doing well, but then later on the church was doing better. This is actually talking in terms of their service and their sanctification. Later on, you'll see in the passage there's a separate. Christ commends those that are holding fast to his teachings, and then there are those that have fallen victim to Jezebel's teaching. And Christ here is talking about this group, the one that has steadfast. The one that has remained steadfast, those that are walking sanctification, he's saying, the good thing is that you are doing greater now than you were doing when you were first born again and you were saved. So what this means for us, principle-wise, is as Christians in sanctification, a good way for us to evaluate and gauge our spiritual, where we are spiritually, is the incline or the decline. Christianity, because God is a living God, because the Word is a living Word, and because God is intimate and personal with us, in our obedience and our walk with Him, we are either on a spiritual incline or we are on a spiritual decline. There is no stagnation. There is no resting. There is no middle flatlining when it comes to the Christian life. You are either on the incline or you are either on the decline. And for us, practically speaking, if this is the commendation that this group of Christians are on the incline, it has us ask ourselves the question, are you is your sanctification on the incline, or is your relationship with Christ on the decline? Because there's no middle ground. If you think that you're a middle ground, you're probably on the decline. And so for us as Christians, and we see this thing, we have to ask ourselves, man, are we in our sanctification? Are we growing? Are we desiring and hungering more for God? It brings me to this image that I've seen in some Christian magazine, but also just in my study, and even at times during my prayer, you would see a fully grown man, like what, 40, 45 years old, and he's has his shirt off and he's in a diaper. When you see Titus, cute little Titus in the diaper, that makes sense. He's pooping, he needs a lot of help and attention, he's dependent, and he can't do anything by himself. That's okay. But then you put that same Huggies diaper on a 45-year-old man and you see something's off, something's wrong. This man who should have grown, who should have eaten, who should have exercised, who should have started to work, and then also started to have a family and bear responsibility, not only procreate, but procreate disciples and then start guiding people and then multiplying those disciples. No one in a diaper is going to be able to do that. But right now, what we see with a lot of Christians and a lot of Christian leaders, out externally, they may seem like they're spiritual because they speak good or they're popular or they influence. People get confused. Influence does not mean spirituality. Influence from people does not necessarily mean that you're in the right with God. Spiritual growth, the incline, your relationship with God internally is what counts. But what you will see internally is people will dress like they're professionals, or like they have responsibility, or they're multiplying, but inside they're just 45-year-olds with diapers. What does it look like to you in your spiritual walk in your life? Are you on the rise? Are you becoming more of a solid, self-sustaining disciple where you're feeding from the Word of God on your own? Or are you just depending on getting fed continually? Are you actually doing the work and bearing responsibility of your own Christian life? Or are you blaming other people, your parents, your church, for your Christian growth? Are you taking responsibility of your own faith, or are you putting that and blaming other people and blame shifting as an excuse for you to stay stagnant in your Christian life? Are you a 20-year-old, 15-year-old that is wearing 4-year-old diapers, spiritually speaking, because you haven't grown although you've been in church your whole life? These are questions that you want to ask, because this church, at least the ones that are being steadfast, they're on the incline. At least this church, they're ones that got rid of the diaper, they're potty trained, they're ready to serve, make disciples, and multiply. This is a good thing. This is the good thing that I really want us to camp out on, so that we challenge ourselves, man, am I so dependent on other people for my Christian life, or am I now being responsible for my own Christian life? This is the shift and hopefully the desire where we as Christians at Lamb Church are on the rise, are on the incline. But let's continue on. When we look at the next verse, we see verse 20. It says, but I have this against you. You tolerate the woman Jezebel. That word tolerate is agree, accept, compromise. We see a lot of this going on. We see for the voice of being tolerant, we compromise. In this generation right now, you just have to look at a few stories on Instagram and Facebook and watch the news. Those that are preaching, be tolerant. They're the most intolerant people. What they're saying is, be tolerant to what I believe, but if you're not tolerant to what I believe, I'm going to be intolerant to you. And so there are stories, countless stories, even on the news, where they preach tolerance, acceptance, and understanding. But in the background, it's only if you accept what they accept. And so this is also the problem here. They have compromised. This church has compromised the negative, the ungodly teachings of Jezebel, the prophetess, and other idol worship and idol sacrifices. So they're saying you don't have to worship just God. You can worship other gods as well. You can not only put your time, value, energies in God and the gospel and missions, but you can put it in other things as well. You can glorify, put your energy and work in other things, but also put God on the side, and that's okay. But the Apostle John, as Jesus is speaking to him and John is pinning this down, he's saying that's not the way that you ought to go. You ought not to compromise, and you ought not to tolerate the things that come from the world. This brings me to a Bible verse that's from the book of James. The book of James, I think it's chapter 5. I can give you the reference at a different time. It's either chapter 3, I think chapter 3, verse 5. But it says this in the New Living Translation. I'll read it from the ESV. In the ESV, it says, "A little leaven leavens the whole lump." And to describe that, the New Living Translation actually does a good job of explaining what this means. It says, "The false teaching is like a little yeast that spreads through the whole batch of dough." The false teaching is like a little yeast that spreads through the whole batch of dough. So what that means is when there is leaven, or when you put in yeast inside bread, you know, it makes it to blow up and to make the bread bigger. In this context, what's being said in terms of compromise is they let a little bit of false teaching inside, and they accepted it inside their church. They knew it was sin, but they tolerated it. And because of that little sin, it has blown up and now taken people outside of the church, divided the church, where there's the steadfast and then there's the compromising. And this being the forest church, where God gives a really strong condemnation, is showing that because of the little bit that you allowed into your life, now things have blown up. You may know this in your life. There are things that are called gateway sins or gateway drugs. A lot of the times when it comes to smoking cigarettes would actually be a gateway drug to get you to be free of your conscience from you, or kill your conscience by continuing doing the smoking cigarettes. And then as you smoke cigarettes, then you would have more access and be more comfortable doing harder, more harmful, destructive drugs. That's a gateway. When it comes into other things right now, I think the Napun stuff that a lot of young people are watching on the screen, that is a gateway towards people treating other people, men and women, in ways they ought not to be. Dishonoring them, not seeing them as brother and sister, but seeing them as objects. There's these little gateway sins that are very small in the beginning, but then it starts to blow up. There's little things like lying, little things like greed, little things like, even like little things like stealing, that they blow up and turn into something where it has completely destroyed your life. And in this case, that little teaching from this one person, although Jezebel is probably symbolic, but these false teachers penetrated into the church and started from the inside out, started to divide it and started to break it. And this is where Christ is laying down the hammer, saying, no more of this. Now, this next part, I want to show you the seriousness of God's holiness and righteousness. In verse 21, this is the recommendation. It says, "I gave her time to repent." God is showing that he's patient. "But she did not want to repent of her immorality. I gave you a chance to repent. You did not repent. And since you didn't repent, I'm going to have to show you the consequences. These consequences are going to be serious, but also these consequences are the consequences that would have come if God would have let them go and do as they pleased in their sin." Check out verse 22. "Behold, I throw her," right? Throw, cast, not just place, throw her on a bed of sickness. The whole bed is covered in sickness. "And those who commit adultery with her in great tribulation, unless they repent of their deeds, I will," now this is graphic, "I will kill her children with pestilence. And all the churches will know that I am he who searches the minds and the souls." Not only is he throwing them on a bed of sickness and of suffering, not only is he casting her in there, but also taking her children. This is the seriousness that God has towards false teaching. the seriousness of false teaching going inside the church, and the seriousness of compromise, the little bit of leaven, the little yeast, the little bit of sin that's in your heart, if you are unwilling to repent of that and give that up, this may be the consequences that you feel in your heart, spiritually speaking, but also physically as well. Christ will not tolerate this sin, because Christ is a Christ of righteousness, of goodness, and of purity, and he cannot sacrifice and compromise his holiness in order to please a few people that want to be satisfied in their sins. So when it comes to the little bit of sin, do not be dismayed or do not be deceived, because Christ looks at that sin seriously. We know that he takes it seriously, because the sickness of bed, this casting out, this pain that you see is put on Jesus Christ on the cross. You see, the seriousness of sin, the wickedness of sin, the disaster of sin when you see Jesus Christ on the cross, and he has already paid for it on the cross. So why are churches going back to their old sins and walking back and bearing the consequences of that sin when Christ has already paid for it? Instead, we ought to repent. We ought not to compromise the little sin that we're dealing with, the stealing, the lust, the anger, the frustration, the unforgiveness that we have, even though it's a little bit, and if we compromise and let that hold place in our heart, it will grow and blow up and it will destroy us. So what does he call us to do? Repent. The next verse, it says, there are those who have not given to those things. Those have stayed steadfast. There are people that are able to be steadfast and walking in obedience with him. On this side, it is compromise, it is being tolerant, and it leads to destruction. On this side, it is compromise and it leads to steadfastness. And then he says, which is very important, verse 25, nevertheless, what you have, hold fast until I come. Until I come. Jesus Christ is going to come back again. And the question is, what side are you on? Are you on the side where you're always tolerating? For the sake of bringing everyone together in different beliefs and not preaching the exclusivity of Jesus Christ, which one are you doing? Are you on the side where you're compromising and tolerating? Or are you on the side where you're holding fast? Are you on the side where you're not giving into false teaching? Are you on the side of really questioning and seeing, are you on the spiritual incline or spiritual decline? Because that's going to be so important for us, especially when Jesus comes back. Because when he comes back, there's going to be those whom he judges righteously. And then there's going to be those that he comes to save, those that have held fast. Lastly, I want to go and jump to verse 29 where it says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Now, this message, some places it's been really, really hot with a lot of condemnation. But man, this is Christ giving another opportunity to us, showing his seriousness, showing his mercy. But he's saying, those who are listening to this, don't let it be in one ear and out the other, but let it be a message that is in one ear, that puts in your mind, that puts it in your heart, that makes it walk out in your life. That you would not be on a downward spiral, but that God, after opportunity, after opportunity, after chance, after chance, after second chance, God is that kind of God that says, if you're going to hear this right now, I'm giving you an opportunity to come back. Come back to me. Come back to truth. Come back to righteousness. Come back to the goodness of God. And guess what? There are going to be people that are against you. There are going to be people that might divide against you. But don't be on the side, don't be on this side, where when Christ comes back, and you are in condemnation. But be on this side, those that are faithful believers in Christ. And when Christ comes back, he will say, well done, my good and faithful servant. I'm encouraged by this passage, because even how immoral this church is, God hasn't given up. And I just want to say to everybody that at Lamb Church and those that are listening at Lamb, God hasn't given up. God isn't the kind of God that gives up on you so quickly, so easily. He's going to woo your heart. He's going to love you. He's going to bless you. But when you're walking astray, he's going to put his foot down and he's going to tell you, this is going to kill you. And I'm going to show you what the consequences look like. Look at the cross. Look at these passages. Look at the bed of sickness. Look at the great tribulation. That tribulation may be there, but in our hearts of hearts, when we're in Christ, we're able to rest in him. Those of us that have tribulation and that are fighting in our hearts, that are having a hard time and have turmoil in our hearts, that are divided, would you come? Take this invitation to come to Christ. Take this invitation to walk with Jesus again. Thank you guys. This concludes the sermon. I want to pray for you guys, and I hope you guys have a really good Sunday. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. We thank you that your word is living and active and sharper than any double-edged sword. We pray that at this time, as we look at this passage at the fourth church and we see this downward decline, may we not be that church that allows the false teaching to creep in. We thank you that Lamb Church holds fast to the doctrines of Christ, that prioritize the gospel of Jesus Christ. We know that you are pleased that our church does that. I pray, Father, furthermore, that you would have our church hold steadfast, waiting, anticipating that you would return to take us home. I pray, Father God, that this warning is not a warning just to condemn, but this warning is a sign of love for the church to come back to you, for the hearts and souls to come back to you. We thank you that you are always a God of grace and love, and that you call us back. I pray that you would help us to furthermore always be on the incline in our spiritual life and never on the decline. Help us not to be those that are in diapers spiritually as we are growing older, but help us, Father God, to walk faithfully, maturing in your grace and your love. We thank you for your presence, your grace. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. May God bless you guys. I love you guys. I'll keep you guys posted on post missions on the Kakao group chat. See you guys later.